Philippine President Marcos Jr. urges Singaporean businesses to consider the Philippines as an investment hub for renewable energy. He told them they can now have full equity in exploring and developing the country's hydro, solar, and wind energy resources. Now, the Philippines' policy shift is aimed to boosting its renewable energy sector and meeting long-term climate targets. Marcos flew to Singapore Wednesday to attend the Milken Institute's 2023 Asian Summit. He touted the Philippines' advantages as an investment destination, such as tax perks and its English-speaking workforce. A Philippine House panel approves the proposed General Appropriations Act of 2024 with no deductions to the government's controversial confidential and intelligence funds. Appropriations Committee Senior Vice Chair Stella Fimbo says plenary deliberations can begin next week, with final approval for the budget targeted before the end of September. The panel retained the government's request for a 5.2 billion peso intelligence budget and a 4.8 billion in confidential funds. It also acceded to the suggestion of the ombudsman to remove the requirement of publishing audit reports. Kimbo said the panel made only two changes to the budget.
There are two changes on the NEP. So one is on the validity of the budget. So we changed it from 1.5 years for MOOE to 2 years. And then the other is on the, we put in a provision, a special provision on the chapter for Congress to ensure the independence of Congress, meaning that that provision would ensure the independence of Congress as a co-equal branch of government.
Manila and Washington vowed to further boost security cooperation following Thursday's Mutual Defense Board meeting of top military officials. The two countries are looking to create more EDCA sites in the Philippines on top of the 9 approved facilities. Additional projects are also being eyed for the approved military sites.
We've increased the number of projects in the already approved sites. We've gone from 32, we've added 63 others, and the United States has identified investment of almost $110 million to those sites to build capability and capacity for the AFP to use every day and for the United States to fall in on when invited.
When we talk about EDCA sites, you know, these are actually, as mentioned, these are existing Philippine camps or Philippine bases. We are just opening this up for shared use with our counterpart, with our only ally, the United States, because we believe that doing certain things together would bring more value. For instance, training together.
The meeting comes on the heels of growing maritime tensions between the Philippines and China. The Philippine military says other countries have also expressed interest to conduct joint patrols in the West Philippine Sea to ensure security in the Indo-Pacific region. A Senate panel starts hearings on proposals seeking to define and institutionalize the Philippines' maritime zones. The Special Committee on Philippine Maritime and Admiralty Zones took up the 10 bills filed in Congress seeking to define the scope of Philippine seas and not just its exclusive economic zone. The Senate assures the public they will pass a law that will further strengthen recognition of territorial waters.
Most especially the waters surrounding the Philippines. Magiging batas na natin, pati yung arbitral ruling, domestic law na natin, domestic legislation. So, mas matibay na yon. And then, pakikipag-usap natin sa international community, bit natin yon.
A local maritime expert says, while international recognition is binding, a domestic law that spells out the scope of the country's seas will not be seen as redundant.
UNCLOS will not automatically amend our laws. Rather, we will do it ourselves. We have a lot of laws that are inconsistent with the new UNCLOS regime.
A Kuwaiti court has convicted the killer of overseas Filipino worker Julibira Nara. The Foreign Affairs Department says a 15-year murder sentence was given to Turki Ayed Al-Azimi, the 17-year-old son of Ranara's employer. He was also slapped with a one-year prison term for driving without a license. The DFA notes lesser penalties handed to Azimi due to him being a minor. The Philippine government, meanwhile, hails the Kuwaiti court's speedy resolution in attaining justice for Ranara. The OFW was found dead in a Kuwaiti desert in January this year. An autopsy report showed she was pregnant at the time of her death. Her murder sparked calls to halt the deployment of Filipino migrant workers to Kuwait and a review to the two countries' labor agreement. Meanwhile, the Philippine Budget Department denies there was no congressional approval for confidential funds given to Vice President Sara Duterte last year. Budget Secretary Amena Pangandaman clarified this in a letter to the House Appropriations Committee. She said the vice president's confidential fund was sourced from a 7 billion peso contingency fund authorized by Congress in the 2022 budget. Now, the contingency fund was for expenses that were not identified during the budget deliberation process. Pangandaman insists the funds given to the vice president's office was not an augmentation nor a fund transfer from the president's office. Transactions of this nature were declared unconstitutional by the Supreme Court in a 2014 ruling penned by Lucas Persamin, who is now the current executive secretary. A Philippine agriculture official disputes a U.S. government report which says the Philippines will soon surpass China as the world's top rice importer. The official says the report missed its mark. Vivian Gulia with the story.
The Philippines is projected to take over China as the world's top rice importer. That's according to the latest report of the United States Department of Agriculture, which estimated that the Philippines' rice imports will hit 3.9 million metric tons for trade year 2022-2023, while China's rice import volume is seen to decline to 3.5 million metric tons from 6.1 million metric tons last trade year. The USDA observed a delay in the Philippines' purchases this year as it awaits lower prices. The country is expected to continue being the top rice importer next year with a projected import volume of 3.8 million metric tons. The Federation of Free Farmers attributes this to the country's increasing rice demand, which is not met by local production.
Sa analysis namin before RTL, we were importing only about 10% of our requirement. Last year, it was already at 21% of our requirement in 1 year. Because we are becoming more reliant on imports, so we will have to be subjected to the price movements in the international market. Ang implication on the government programs are not succeeding in improving local production.
Group Mantay Bigas believes the growing rice imports is a result of the government's failure to improve local rice production. Agriculture Undersecretary Leocadio Sebastian, meanwhile, disputes the USDA's projection, saying the DA expects to import much less than the figure cited in the report for this year and the next, with intensified efforts to produce more rice locally. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., who also heads the Agriculture Department on Wednesday, admitted the Philippines cannot be dependent on rice imports, adding that local production should be developed.
This is a lesson that we immediately learned. He said we cannot now continue to depend on importation, which is what has happened for the Philippines. In the past years, it became the easy way out.
Some farmers groups expressed their opposition to reduce rice import tariffs and called for a thorough review before a decision is made.
Kung binaba mo yung tariff doon, wala naman assurance na ibaba ng importer yung presyo ng bigas dahil wala namang cap yung presyo nila.
Karamihan ng mga inaangkat natin bigas ay yung mga mamahaling grado that is sold to well-off consumers. If we bring down the tariff for those types of rice, hindi makikinabang yung mahihirap.
The distribution of subsidies to rice retailers continues with nearly 200 recipients in Manila on Thursday and less than 100 in Malabon. Some rice retailers say the 15,000 peso subsidy is not enough to cover their losses from the enforcement of the price cap on rice, but they are still grateful for the assistance.
Nasa 25,000 siguro. Ayaw naman din namin mahuli at maparusahan kasi
the local governments of Manila and Malabon are studying the possibility of augmenting the national government subsidy if the period for the price cap drags longer. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine regulators allay fears of a possible sugar shortage in the country. The Sugar Regulatory Administration sees next year's domestic demand for sugar reaching up to 2.3 million metric tons. It gave the assurance of sufficient stocks, with more to come as the harvest season is underway. It says it's monitoring sugar production and how this might be affected by the El Nino phenomenon.
Last year po kasi, yung total production natin is 1.799 million metric tons. Sa ngayon po, we are estimating an increase to 1.85 million metric tons. Kaso po, yung nilagay po natin sa sugar order na there is a possibility na bababa po yung 1.85 million natin ng 10% to 15%, depending on the forecasted El Nino. Sa ngayon, okay pa tayo. Okay. Yung expected po na El Nino is November to January yata yung forecast ng PAGASA. So we will monitor the severity of this. And we will see if it will bring about a decrease on the estimated production.
The Philippine Civil Defense Office records over 44 million pesos of infrastructure damage from the magnitude 6.4 earthquake that hit Cagayan Province. It says 174 people were affected, with around 98 people still in evacuation centers. At least 5 people were injured. The earthquake struck Calayan Municipality Tuesday evening. Its epicenter was 26 kilometers west of Dalupidi Island.